Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable. Hello and welcome to this week's episode of The Luxury of Poverty. I'm your host, A.B. Ravi. Generally speaking, most of us are scared of failure. So we avoid taking risks as there is fear of losing job or money or becoming a laughing stock. This fear of failure forces many to settle to a life of mediocrity. But as they say, no risk, no gain. Perhaps this is what separates men from the boys. People who take risks see opportunities in adversity. They are ambitious, focused and bold. They are not cowed on by disadvantages or poverty. It is this attitude that catapults them into the big league. My guest, Dr. A. Velumani, falls into this category. He considers himself lucky to be born into poverty. But for that, he would not have made it big. Dr. Velumani, who runs a successful company, Thyrocare Technologies, is worth 2,000 crore rupees today. I mean his personal net worth. He brings an entrepreneur's perspective while decoding the success mantra of entrepreneurs featured in our show. With this thought of mine, let me focus to the hero of this week's episode. Suresh Wazirani, the man who built Transasia Biomedicals. He is an entrepreneur not by choice, but by chance. At an age when everybody thinks of career and money, Suresh gave up his well-paying job to devote his life to do social work. But destiny had something else in store for him. A chance visit to Mumbai's Jaslok Hospital in the late 70s changed his life and fortune forever. Today, Transasia Biomedical is one of the largest in vitro diagnostic company. Take a look.
He is an entrepreneur by chance and not by choice. Suresh Wazirani, the man who built Transasia Biomedicals, was happily working as a trainee engineer at the Arvind Mafatlal Group Company, Nossal in Mumbai. One evening he attended a play organized by Mahatma Gandhi's grandson, Rajmohan Gandhi. That play deeply impacted him, so much so that he decided to quit his well-paying job and join hands with Rajmohan Gandhi to do social service. His parents were disappointed. After all, he was the breadwinner. But the family fangs and emotions did not deter this electrical engineer from pursuing his path. After all, he had grown up in an environment of freedom fighters and refugee camps. But what changed his fortune was his chance to visit Mumbai's Jaslok Hospital with Rajmohan Gandhi to meet the socialist leader Jayaprakash Narayan, who was undergoing a dialysis treatment. It was there that he saw how ill-equipped hospitals were in relation to diagnostic machines. That was 1977. This triggered a business idea in Suresh. He decided to set up a diagnostic equipment company that was affordable to people. The dream was big, but he had only 250 rupees in his pocket. Fortunately, a friend, seeing Suresh's passion and determination to do something good in the healthcare space, loaned him 1 lakh rupees. With this money, Suresh visited some of the best diagnostic equipment makers around the world. In 6 months' time, he had visited over 70 companies and in the process managed to convince a few to appoint him as their distributors in India. Thus was born Transasia Biomedicals in 1979. Initially, as a distributor, they were importing dialysis machines from Japan. But with imports proving to be costly, he got into the manufacturing of diagnostic equipment by setting up a plant at Seeps in Mumbai in 1990. After that, there was no looking back. Transasia Biomedicals moved up the value chain by manufacturing a whole range of products in India. With the cash registers ringing, he decided to get the latest in technology by acquiring over 11 companies abroad. Today, Transasia Group has manufacturing facilities in USA, UK, Czech Republic, Italy, France and Turkey. This strategy has given Transasia the twin benefits of being a manufacturer in low-cost India and gaining access to high-end technology abroad. Today, Transasia Biomedicals is a 1,000 crore rupee plus turnover company and one of the largest in vitro diagnostic companies with an employee strength of 1,200. It offers solutions and products in biochemistry, hematology, coagulation, ESR, immunology, urinalysis, critical care, diabetes management, microbiology, and molecular diagnostics. In fact, TransAsia is the first Indian company to manufacture and export sophisticated state-of-the-art blood analyzers and reagents under the brand name Erba to more than 100 countries. Clearly, Suresh Vazirani's dream to make affordable diagnostic equipment in India so that people can take care of their health through prevention has indeed been fulfilled. May his tribe increase.
So this has further strengthened my belief that where you follow your conviction, where you follow your mission, the resources follow. So we started this company with 250 rupees, no knowledge, no expertise, no engineers in the company. We started, I was the first engineer, I was the first manager, I was the only engineer in the company. And in 36 years, today here we are, TransAsia is the largest diagnostic company in India. This proves that, you know, where you follow your conviction, resources will follow.
Dr. Mani, welcome to the show. Looking at Suresh Vazirani, what's your first impression on this company?
Mr. Suresh Vazirani was an entrepreneur even 18 years before I ventured.
Yeah.
So if you look at it, two generations have been in between.
Yeah.
And in those days, becoming an entrepreneur, that itself is a very big dream. That too in healthcare. And in diagnostics, nothing was available in India. Even the raw material, even the basic components were not of any quality in India. I'm talking about 1977 to 85.
Yeah,
I correct. Think starting a business at that time obviously was needing a lot of boldness.
Yeah.
And I know him as a man who came from Nagpur with an engineering degree in hand.
Yeah, correct.
I think he hardly worked for an year or two. The entrepreneurial bug bit him much earlier than it does for others. And I think he did not truly worry about not having funds or not having knowledge. But I think his determination paid him off. Today the company is a very powerful company in the Indian diagnostic space. He has a huge field force, engineers.
Okay.
Having trained field engineers is the biggest strength in medical diagnostics business in any country. He was very successful in working out relationships. I think his relationship with Sysmax is as old as 25 years.
Oh.
And that relationship gave him a basic standing in the marketplace. Because in hematology, even today, globally, the strongest player is Sysmax. And for India, he has been in the helm of affairs for 25 years. I think the number of installations runs in thousands and across the country. And with so many engineers in the field, I think he has established himself as the most powerful diagnostic player. And other than that, he has manufacturing premises across the country in a couple of locations and across the globe in various locations in Europe. I think he has managed to see pretty early what his risk is.
Okay.
And got it right.
Vazirani's story is indeed fascinating. It is clear there are ample opportunities all around us, but you need to keep your eyes and ears open to grab it. On that note, we need to take a short commercial break. When we come back, we will look at how Suresh Vazirani was smitten by the entrepreneurial bug. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Clearly, Suresh Vazirani is an entrepreneur by chance, not by choice. He left a well-paying job to do social service with Rajmohan Gandhi, the grandson of Mahatma Gandhi. But one incident changed his life forever. So what was that eureka moment? Let's listen into Suresh Vazirani.
I remember very well one evening, Mr. Jayaprakash Narayan had come for urgent dialysis in the hospital. and the machine was not working. And everybody was nervous because Mr. Narayan needed the dialysis immediately within a few hours, otherwise there could be serious consequences. I asked the staff why there is no engineer to repair the machine. They said there is no engineer because there is only one engineer trained in this one and he was away in New Delhi. And that made me really aware that country of our size, there is only one engineer available for dialysis. However, the reality was, here was Mr. Jayaprakash Narayan who needed the dialysis and he was a machine that was not working. What should be done? So jokingly, one of the staff said, Suresh, you are an engineer, why don't you do something about it? And I said, well, I never seen a dialysis machine before. I don't know what's wrong with it, but something has to be done. We cannot just let the situation go like this. Mr. Narayan has to have a dialysis. So what do we do? So I sat, I called the technician, both of us sat there, started reading the manual, opened the machine, and fortunately, in 3-4 hours' time, we were able to make it work. Out of two machines, we were able to make one machine work by changing the parts and things like that. So this was a great revelation that there is a great need in India for engineering support and for technology. And I felt I should help bridge that gap.
Okay, Dr. Velumani, looking at his bite, was it destiny or did he seize both the opportunity? It was a chance visit to Jaslaw Hospital and he repaired a dialysis machine. So would you call him an entrepreneur by choice or by accident?
I think he was to become an entrepreneur, if not then, maybe after a couple of more weeks, months or years.
Okay.
I don't think an entrepreneur can be stopped getting into that slot too long by anyone. So always it's some incident which triggers.
Yeah.
There has been a huge multinational domination in this field for the last 4 decades. I think someone who thought, why always import, why not we make in our own country? You know, today we talk about make in India. I think Mr. Suresh Vajrani did not use that as a logo, make in India.
But not I think a slogan, he put it into practice.
He got into business.
Yeah.
And one thing good about his approach is he sees the pyramid very well. Pyramid of diagnostic space. There are star hospitals and laboratories in the top of the pyramid. There are small village polyclinics and diagnostic laboratories in the bottom of the pyramid. He knows all cannot afford to have imported stuff. And all imported stuff costs upward to 50 lakhs, 80 lakhs and 1 crore. So he set up diagnostic instruments ranging from 1 lakh to 40 lakh. And I think his strength is reaching to every nooks and corners of the country.
It was a modest beginning. With friendly loan of 1 lakh rupees, Suresh Vajrani started TransAsia Biomedicals. But after a few years, realized that importing machine was not serving the purpose for which he started the company. So he decided to get into manufacturing. So what gave him the confidence he could pull it off? Let's listen into Suresh.
So we started importing blood testing machines, diagnostic machines, and helping laboratories do the tests which can prevent disease. You know. But again, we soon realized that these imported machines are so expensive that not many laboratories in India can afford. Yeah. So this, I felt that it's absolutely important that large country like India cannot depend on importing these machines. And it's not only expensive, but every part, every consumable had to be imported, you see. And that made it very difficult to give proper technical support, to keep the machines working. It was very difficult because everything had to be imported. And in those days, the imports were not so easy. There were a lot of restrictions then. So I felt that it's unfortunate that in India, nobody was manufacturing this, that everything had to be imported. So I felt that I should start manufacturing these machines in India. So I got together a few of our service engineers and I said, you guys are trained in servicing and repairing the machines. Can't we make it in India? Everybody was very enthusiastic. They said, yes, we can. So we started a small R&D cell and made the first machine in 1991.
So for the first 11, he started, was only importing. Then he got into manufacturing. Do you think it was a bold move? Because he had no knowledge of manufacturing and neither did he have the technology. Your comment.
No, he has no alternative because the imported gadgets and their spares were not an affordable commodity for the middle class in the country who wanted to run laboratories. So either he limits his business or he sees an opportunity there. So according to me, he found that there is an opportunity to get the medium-sized, medium-priced solutions for the laboratories of the interior parts of the country.
Okay.
One unfortunate part in the healthcare or a diagnostic industry is Europe, US and Japan, even today, rules 95% of the instrumentation and reagent market. The complete monopoly by these markets of this particular segment probably forced Mr. Suresh to think, is that we can't do. But having said that, for the hard work he has put in, he did not get, according to me, adequate returns. Once again, the monopoly part of these three parts of the world is continuing. Nothing is manufactured anywhere outside these three geographies. That's the limitation of the space. But in spite of that, today if he says I am exporting outside India, which I am pretty sure he does for some 30% of his total turnover, that's the strength. And getting a foreign exchange for an Indian multinational diagnostic company is a very satisfying feeling.
Well, the story is getting interesting, but it's time for another short commercial break. When we come back, we will look at how Suresh Wazirani transformed the company with his Make in India strategy and series of acquisitions abroad. Stay tuned. Welcome back. Undoubtedly, acquiring companies abroad for the latest technology has indeed helped TransAsia Biomedicals to carve a strong niche in the diagnostic business space. Today, more than 50 crore people have their blood tests done on equipment made by TransAsia. And this number is growing by leaps and bounds, looking at the way lifestyle diseases are going up. Is Wazirani ready for the future? Let's hear what he has to say.
We are very happy that today more than 50 crore people get their blood tested on our machines. And that's a huge number. But compared to what we need to do, still it's a small number. There are more than 250 crore people who need this equipment. Now, how do we take it there? So we are working on a plan to extend our technical support and product support in all the emerging markets where there are large populations and people there do not have similar things. So this is our next mission, is to take it from 50 crores to 250 crores in next 5 years.
So 5x in 5 years, is it doable?
It's very much doable, especially when you have in the country 90% of the laboratories with at least one machine of TransAsia in the floor. That means you have occupied the market completely. So any test done there is your count. So I have a reason to believe this 50 to 250 is very much possible. If not in 3 years, 5 years, it should be doable in at least 10 years period. And the market is big. It is growing very fast. It is said in India that the diagnostic market is growing 16%, but the competition in this space is growing 22%. Now, that growth of 22% is certainly a business opportunity for TransAsia, because every laboratory who wants to start needs to have instrument and affordable instruments, and he is very much there in the marketplace.
Okay.
So that gives him an advantage to be ahead in the Indian diagnostic space among his peers, and numbers in India is doable.
Okay, I want to ask you, he started this business with the premise that he wanted to make healthcare affordable in his own way. So can you blend business and social concern or social work together? Today people talk about CSR activity. What's your take there?
I think I see him contributing in creating employment.
Mm-hmm.
That's one aspect of the CSR. The other one is he is creating employment in the marketplace, because anybody who wants to become an entrepreneur needs affordable gadgets and reagent.
Yeah.
So he is very much there. So if you look at it, these two are more than satisfying CSR, if one calls it as a need. But other than that, I know him as a man of philanthropy. He has been supporting in many social activities, and in fact, me and he together are supporting a few aspects.
So you think it is possible to mix business and philanthropy together?
Business is philanthropy.
Okay.
Creating jobs is philanthropy. Creating solutions is philanthropy. Then philanthropy need not have business. Once you are a rich man, you have enough money, and you can put that separately into philanthropy also.
Thank Dr. Velamuni for sharing your views. Well, what appeals to me most about Suresh Wazirani is that in the initial phase of his life, he did not seem ambitious. He was contented doing social work. But once he got a business idea, he became restless till he achieved his objective. He had his eureka moment and he cashed on it. So my advice to those aspiring to become an entrepreneur, keep looking for those eureka moments in your life. On that thinking note, it is time to say goodbye. See you next week with another interesting episode. Till then, keep watching CNBC TV 18.
Focus. Ideate. Innovate. Enable.